syncopated beats and stuff like that, which are now so much part of the kind of landscape of music that it's difficult to understand how weird that sounded in like 1989.
While Manchester was enjoying a cultural explosion, their neighbours in Liverpool were basking in summer sporting success. The 1989 FA Cup final was a Merseyside derby. Out. With the scores level deep into extra time, it was a nail-biter.
McMahon, Barnes. Rush! Goal! 3-2 Liverpool! Ian Rush gets his second! And this now becomes one of the most dramatic FA Cup finals of recent times.
Liverpool's victory had a bittersweet quality to it. A month earlier, the club had lost 95 of its fans, many very young, at the Hillsborough Stadium disaster. Bad management of the crowds had led to the fatal crush. The tragedy was too much to bear for fans of an already beleaguered game. Throughout the 80s, football had been blighted by terrorist violence, a seemingly intractable problem. Indeed, the tragedy at Hillsborough might have been averted had the police not assumed they were dealing with crowd trouble.
Terrorist violence was a real problem. This was a period of a really rather frightening disorder, which needed legislation, but drafting that, getting that right, getting the clubs to agree to it, getting it through the House of Commons was one of the most difficult sort of technical, political things that we had to do, and it was very important.
Despite the best efforts of the police and government, the hooligans had not gone away. Bizarrely, the solution to this scourge of society lay in the rave scene. Cass Pennant was a leader of the notorious West Ham hooligan firm, the ICF.
I remember a lot of the West Ham lads who'd come up to me on a Saturday at football, you know, what's happening to our leaders? What's all this rave music, you know? Have we gone soft, or we fighting, or we raving?
It was hilarious. I mean, so many of the football boys out there lightened up an incredible amount, and I think that that's probably got to be down to something, maybe a little pill here or there.
The loved-up vibe generated by ecstasy was infectious, even for the most hardened hooligans. It wasn't long before the firms were organising parties themselves.
I was employing a security, but there's only two of us. I mean, it was so peaceful, these rapes. I'll never forget, the promoter come up and said, "Cass, behave yourself." I said, "Why is that in?" He said, "You've got some guests that you ain't going to like." And I said, "Oh, who's that in?" He said, "Millwall." I said, "Yeah, that's not a problem. You know what I mean? I've seen everyone getting on. You know what I mean?" "No," he said, "you ain't going to like this. Yeah, there could be as many as 200. I said, "What?" I said, "You've employed two of us." He said, "Well, there'll be a few other teams as well, Chelsea, Arsenal, all mixed in." He said, "Look, you've only got a problem because you're old guard, you're old school." He said, "You've got to get with it."
I absolutely played witness to seeing Millwall and Chelsea dancing together, hugging each other and talking to each other. And they would normally obviously be killing each other, you know, after invading a pitch somewhere.
I couldn't believe the whole night, was just a great buzz. You know, it's just one big loving.
It wasn't just football hooligans who were putting their differences aside.
That's the thing about the rave culture and ecstasy. It broke down barriers between people, because in Thatcher's Britain it was more like a divide and conquer kind of thing. And you're a Scouse and I hate you because you're from Liverpool and you cockney wanking and that. I think there was a revolution of the mind with people, and all those old attitudes were broke down.
There was a coming together of classes. You'd get Emma Ridley and girls like that, which were the it girls of the day. You'd get football hooligans for West Ham supporters, you'd get rude boys from Brixton, you'd get black, white, rich, poor, everyone really coming together.
This spirit of togetherness had echoes of another loved-up era, the hippie movement and 1967's Summer of Love.
Some people kind of try and talk about 89 as, you know, the second summer of love. because there was a sense, like the hippies, that in 89, it wasn't about Labour or Tory, it was about this world or a different world. Love, love, love.
We are going to change the world. We're going to make everyone happy people. We're going to make everyone like us. And that was new. That was special. We really thought we was like starting a revolution.
But there was an irony at the heart of this idealistic youth movement. By now, the rave scene was being run by businessmen.
On one hand, you've got the whole generation of people who wanted to escape this sort of Thatcherite rule. And sort of acid house is sort of a big part of that. On the other hand, you'd got people who were making the sort of money out of it who could have only been using the sort of enterprise that was set free in Thatcher's time as well.
Some of the biggest rave promoters had learned their trade organising a very different type of party. The notorious Gatecrasher Balls in London catered for hormone-raging, alcohol-guzzling public school kids.
What have you been drinking? Vodka, wine, you name it, I've been drunk here.
The 19-year-old entrepreneur behind the Gatecrashers was Jeremy Taylor. By the summer of 89, Jeremy had got out of the ball business and turned his hand to raves.
I definitely felt I was one of Thatcher's children, absolutely. With the balls and then the raves, I don't think I could possibly get out of that one.
The rave culture was very entrepreneurial, and they were kids who had got on their bikes, got on their mobile phones, and, you know, set up these parties. They were Thatcher's children. She has only herself to blame.
The parties may have been enterprising, but they were also illegal. In 1989, obtaining a licence for an all-night event was impossible, so avoiding the long arm of the law was paramount.
It was so important to keep the location secret, because if it got out, you know, that your party was off. So we used to have several venues. So we'd have, you know, a backup venue, and a backup venue again. It really was the most closely kept secret since the Holy Grail.
Rave locations ranged from farmers' fields to aircraft hangars dotted across the home counties. Now easily accessible, courtesy of the newly completed M25 motorway around London. To keep venues secret, organisers provided only a phone number for partygoers to call to get directions at an allotted time.
Going to a party was quite a journey. It was a magical mystery tour. You'd have a ticket. It would have a 0898 number.
People would go to phone boxes, ring this number, stuff in however many pound coins you needed to actually get an answer, write down the location, and head off.
You'd sort of see cars going from all directions from the suburbs of London, hundreds of people dressed a little bit differently, maybe converging. There'd be a car park where there'd be a sort of pre-party party, everyone going, do you know where it is? There'd be like a convoy going around the M25.
You'd drive around and you'd look for lasers, the laser light. It was like Close Encounters. So you're driving through some dark field in the middle of something, then all of a sudden you just see a light and you'd follow the light. Before you knew it, you had 100 cars behind you, and you used to get to these parties and be about 100 people, then you look around and there was like 10,000 people.
When they stumbled across a rave, the rural police forces often took an indulgent approach towards these strange gatherings.
I think we soon realised that they were no great threat to us in terms of overt violence. But of course, they're young and they want to party. When we stopped them on the motorways, they would get a portable radio out and they'd all dance around the car for half an hour, you know, to their hip music and all this kind of thing.
In the early stages, the police had no idea. And in fact, in the very early days, the police were quite happy to help park cars. And I think they were quite happy that everything was all contained under one roof.
But while at first the police were happy to humour the mass gatherings of young people in Britain, elsewhere in the world, there were authorities less willing to tolerate youthful rebellion.
The daylight hours have seen more violence, with young people...
On the 4th of June, the Chinese government finally lost patience with the students who had been occupying Tiananmen Square for the past 7 weeks, and ordered the army to open fire. The crowd